And we turn to the analysis of Shields and Gerson. That's syndicated columnist Mark Shields and Washington Post columnist Michael Gerson. David Brooks is off tonight. Welcome, gentlemen. Mark, the president left town on Wednesday proclaiming a season of progress. Was he right? And if so, how did it happen?
He was right. It was a season of progress in the sense that the level of expectation, especially after the 2nd of November's shellacking, the gerund of the year, was quite low. Democratic spirits were low, disheartened, even made further low down by the president's surprise tax deal with Mitch McConnell. And then he went from being James Buchanan, Millard Fillmore, to being a little Teddy Roosevelt. And by the end of having passed START and the STAT Treaty and Don't Ask, Don't Tell, there were flashes of FDR. I mean, it was rather remarkable. Quite a transformation, and showing once again the restraint and measured good judgment of all our colleagues in the press. Who overwrote and overreacted the story. But there's no question that Democrats were heartened by the fact that he did not look like he was going to be a pushover in the next session. I think that as much as anything.
All right, maybe we'll get back to the press and the narrative.
Sure. But first,
how did it happen? What do you ascribe
it to? Well, I do think it's mainly an indication that if a president is willing to make a deal, he can usually get a deal. He did that on the tax bill. Essentially, this second stimulus package was pretty much what Republicans wanted the first time around on the stimulus package. And even on the START Treaty, he gave specific assurances about nuclear modernization. And, so I think he gave Republicans something and got something in return. That's a real contrast, for example, to the way that health care was passed in kind of a march of party line votes. And this is a different way of governing. I think it's important to say, though, that on the budget issues, the fiscal issues, the Republicans really didn't budge. They defeated the omnibus spending bill, a $1 trillion package with 6,700, earmarks. And that, I think, is a preview of the battles we're going to have in the next session.
But do you think, in terms of lessons learned, if we think about the president, it was compromise, work with Republicans? That's what you think happened.
Well, I think you have to give something in order to get something. And that's usually the case, even when you're president of the United States.
Lessons learned for the president.
Well, I think that several. First of all, I think the president himself got more engaged. Michael raised health care. I think there's no question that, especially during that fallow 4-month period, was with the Senate Finance Committee, health care languished when they were going to strike a deal with all these Republicans. And as soon as the first Tea Party, the first town meeting was held, it was pretty apparent you weren't going to win any of those Republican votes. But still, he didn't get personally involved and engaged the same way he did in this session. He did certainly on START. I think START was a great testimony to that there is life after a presidential campaign. John Kerry did a masterful job. I mean, Republicans acknowledge that. Dick Lugar was, as he always is, a stalwart on these. And it was a signal victory in the sense that you defeated the two leaders of the Republican Party who were all out against it. Mitch McConnell and John Kyle were out against this totally, and John McCain the last time standard bearer. So it was quite an achievement. But I think the fact that the president himself was involved made a major difference.
So we continue with the lessons learned here for Republicans. What should Republicans take from the last week or so?
Well, you know, there's a lot of debate among Republicans on these issues. Some people saying that they rolled over in this last period. They didn't really have much choice. I mean, the president on the tax bill in particular, I mean, we're going to end up in the 4 years of the Obama administration with tax rates the same as when it began, which Republicans would not have predicted in this circumstance. And so they had to take a victory in a certain way. They couldn't refuse it just to hurt the president. And this is a case where the president's interests in a growing economy are the country's interests. So I think that Republicans here, were put in a position, particularly on those two votes, Don't Ask, Don't Tell, and START. Those were more votes of conscience. I don't think that McConnell and others pressed hard on those issues. They were really, in that category of votes of conscience. I think the fiscal issues are going to be the dividing ground here, and that's what we're going to see in the next time.
But on the Lindsey Graham quote was, "When all is going to be said and done, Harry Reid has eaten our lunch."
Yeah, I saw that, and it's interesting because Lindsey Graham, if anything, what I find most fascinating about the Republicans, and I think Mitch McConnell is the epitome of this, is that the Tea Party is a major player. They are mindful of what happened in the 2010 primaries, and certainly McConnell is mindful of what happened where his own favorite candidate, Trey Grayson, the Secretary of State, was whomped by Rand Paul and the Tea Party. And so I think, and Jim DeMint kind of roams the Senate as the unofficial Tea Party leader. Mm-hmm. So I think there's a lot of that going on, even in Lindsey Graham, who kind of succeeded to the John McCain role of the negotiator with the other side. He's pulled back. He's mindful. He's up in 2012. He's got a primary challenge already announced against him in South Carolina. And he's kind of turned in a fierce border patrol man on the immigration bill. So I think there are lessons there for Republicans. I think they were very, and understandably so, because the Democrats were really down, they were really full of themselves after,
right after the election.
I mean, mm-hmm. And don't forget this, there's an entirely different cast of characters as of January 5th. I mean, all of a sudden, 63 new Republicans are coming mm-hmm. in. Michael mentioned the victory on the budget bill. In a strange way, that's going to be a difficult moment for John Boehner, because it expires on the 4th of March, the funding of the government does. And that's going to run right up to face to cheek to jowl with the statutory raising of the debt ceiling. And those are going to be tough votes. And for John Boehner, as the Speaker of the House, the majority party's responsibility is to provide the votes for that. And I think it's going to be a tough sledding for him.
Well, so when you look ahead to next month and the new politics that's coming here, do we look at this past week or two as a kind of blip, marking the end of an era, or a harbinger of what might come in terms of compromise and getting some things passed?
Well, I do think that at least the early months of the new term are going to be characterized by battles over health care, because mm-hmm. Republicans are absolutely committed to both do oversight hearings mm-hmm. to try to make the case against health care and also to defund the implementation of health care, which they did by opposing the omnibus bill, which was, right. much of that was kind of, you know, was intended for that purpose. And so there'll be a huge battle on that, and then a huge battle on budget and fiscal issues. The president, that's going to be very interesting, the State of the Union, which I'm very interested in, how he positions himself on those mm-hmm. fiscal issues. They've already said this is going to be the focus of his remarks. How does he turn that corner mm-hmm. and go towards this? Does he talk about entitlements, which are the real problem? Those are the big issues there. Can he put Republicans on the defensive on spending? That's the question.
What do you think when you look ahead? I mean, do you see this period is continuing,
back to... We will look back on this period nostalgically. I really do. I think this was probably the height of cooperation and collaboration. I mean, cooperation and bipartisanship, because in many quarters from this point forward, cooperation will be seen as collaboration and put one at political risk for doing so.
Let me ask you about one issue that the president, another issue that he brought up at the press conference, that he was talking about his evolving thinking on gay marriage. After the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell, is there some kind of momentum that you see for going further?
Well, there are 30 years of momentum on mm-hmm. the gay rights issue. Mm-hmm. It's really an extraordinary change in American views and mores and values. There is odd heroes of the gay rights movement in this case, because it's really Secretary Gates and Admiral Mullen in the military that drove this through. They didn't want the courts to decide this. Mm-hmm. They wanted to do it on their own terms. So they made this decision to move forward. This is an issue where I think Americans have very much decided that homosexuals should have equal rights. I think gay marriage is still very much a 50-50 debate in mm-hmm. America. So even if you have a vote in California, you know, one of the most liberal states in the country, you get a vote against gay marriage. But I think Joe Biden was right this week that the trend line is pretty clear on where this is headed.
What do you see?
6 years from 2004, where in the re-election campaign of President Bush, it was an issue in a number of states, the same-sex referendum questions that were encouraged. Its support for it has doubled. For legal same-sex marriage, even among Republicans, it's doubled. Now, it's still only 25% of Republicans favor it, unlike both Democrats and independents. But I think there is a move. And the president, I think, did something very smart. He tied the don't ask, don't tell to service and sacrifice. I mean, these are people who love their country, who want to serve their country, and willing to die for their country. And who are we to deny them full citizenship? And I think he made the same argument for the DREAM Act, which did not pass, which was for Latinos who grew up in this country, were brought here by their parents at the age of 5, 9, or 11, and then grew up here and want to, again, could serve in the military to reach citizenship status. And I think he's making that same argument, and I think it's a very persuasive argument.
He pointed to that as his
people
one
service, sacrifice, and the civil rights go with it.
Yeah. Let me, in our last time, maybe I should come back to the media bashing that you started here.
No, I just...
you couldn't resist.
It's just, I mean, you know, it's 10 o'clock in the morning on one cable station. It's literally, he's Ulysses Grant. And by noon, you know, the president has been transformed to a little bit of Harry Truman, a dollop of TR and flashes of Jack Kennedy. I mean, it's just overriding and overheated.
You know, I agree with that. I saw it in government. There's a tendency to play the game of up, down, weak, strong. That's the narrative of these arguments. I think they exaggerated the president's weakness in a certain way. I mean, the president, particularly if you have one or both houses of Congress, is never irrelevant. I mean, he has a significant role in this, and I think they exaggerated the upside, the upside now as well. I mean, this is a case where the president's going to face a whole new world in this coming year. There are at least 42 hard fiscal conservatives in the Senate that are going to control a lot, and a new House leadership. And it's, he's going to face a different world.
At least three quarters of whom had earmarks in the in the under the spending.
Couldn't resist.
Well,
right?
I mean, fiscal conservatism and fiscal conservatism.
All right.
To open a definition.
Stay tuned then. Mark Shields, Michael
Thank
Gerson,
you.
Thanks a lot. And happy holidays.
Thank you. Merry Christmas. Thank you.